Well, let's officially start then. This is a warm welcome from thebuddhistcentre.com. I'm Aparajita. I've known Shantigarbha a fair few years, and mostly we've overlapped doing work with the order together. And he's a great guy. I'm sure a lot of you know him. He's probably most famous, as it were, for his NVC work, nonviolent communication. His Buddhist name, Shantigarbha, means seed of peace. And if you want to check out what he does NVC wise, then seedofpeace.org is his website. And you can see what he gets up to in terms of courses and training. So, yeah, that'll do, won't it? Over to you, Shantigarbha. Sock it to us. Oh,
Thank
by
you.
the way,
Yeah, go.
I can only assume that Shantigarbha is not a football fan because this is exactly scheduled for the culmination of the Premier League today. So, Sadhu on your renunciation, those of you that would quite like to be watching that. Over to you, Shantigarbha.
Thank you very much, Aparajita. So just
Oh,
a
thank
reminder
you.
that this session is being recorded. So if you don't want to appear, then do switch your camera off so it is being recorded for posterity, or at least for people who can't make this particular time. So I'm Shantigarbha, and I'm a member of the Triratana Buddhist Order, as Aparajita mentioned, and I describe myself as a Buddhist activist. So today I'd like to explore a Buddhist response to what I'm calling the climate and ecological emergency, and I'll also explain more about why I'm doing that. So I'd like to start with an arriving exercise to help us to become present to ourselves, to each other, and to the earth. So I invite you to get comfortable to sit for 8 or 10 minutes, and I'll lead through body, feelings, and intentions. Body, feelings, and intentions. So when you're ready, eyes open or closed, bringing your attention inside your body, inside the envelope of your skin, and getting an overall sense of your body. And when you're ready, allowing your attention to trickle all the way down your torso, down your legs, to your feet and your toes. Your connection with the earth, the feet, the soles of the feet. The heels and ankles. Calves and knees. Thighs and sitting bones. Allowing the earth to take your weight. Pelvis and lower back. Upper back. Spreading into the shoulder blades and down the arms to the elbows, forearms and hands with fingers and thumbs. And sensing the life in your hands, in the fingertips, in the palms, warm or cool, dry or moist, tingly or numb. And when you're ready, bring your attention to your stomach, to your belly, noticing any swirls of tension. Any areas of ease and relaxation in your body. Coming through to the lower back again, and following the spine upwards between the shoulder blades to neck and head. And if it helps, allow the muscles at the back of the neck, at the base of the skull, to relax and lengthen. Noticing the scalp and ears. Forehead and eyes. Nose and mouth. Chin and throat. And chest with heart and lungs. And if it helps you to arrive and become present, following your breath in and out, right at 10 breaths. When you're ready, sensing what you're feeling at the moment. So checking in around your heart. Perhaps lower down, perhaps further up. Sensing what you're feeling. And sensing if this feeling has a colour connected to it. Or an image. Or a sound. Or a texture. Even a taste or a smell. And when you're ready, exploring your intention. Your intentions for coming here today. Perhaps to do some healing. Perhaps to learn some new skills. Perhaps to create the kind of world you want to live in. Perhaps all of these and others. So getting in touch with your intention, your intentions. And in a minute, we're going to bring this arriving exercise to a close. So finishing off in whatever way you choose. And in your own time, opening your eyes, looking around, taking in the other people on the call. And we're going to continue with a check-in round. So we're going to go into groups of three, breakout rooms of three. And you have 3 minutes each to say how you're doing, what's alive in you right now in relation to what I'm calling the climate and ecological emergency. Okay, so welcome back. So I'd like to give everybody a chance to say your name and how you're doing. So just a word or a sentence, so we get a flavor of each person. So a word or a sentence, so a flavor. So, okay. So let's start with Aparajita and then Angie and then Sophia. How are you doing in a word or a sentence?
Well, I'm not sure if that sentence can include semicolons and dot, dot, dot.
If you take a breath, there's a full stop.
But I'm quite good at brevity as well. My name's Aparajita from sort of north of Manchester, UK. I'm feeling good, quite happy, quite expansive, quite slightly preoccupied with the football, but let's not dwell on that.
Thank you. Thanks. Angie, and then Sophia, and then Sarah.
I'm Angie. I'm from Ipswich Sango in Suffolk. Sorry I'm late. And I am feeling inspired recently by the work of Joanna Macy, linking it to dependent arising after the Buddha Field retreat last week. And so this is really timely for me.
Okay, welcome Angie, Sophia, Sarah, and then Helen.
Hi, I'm Sophia. I live in Bristol. Yeah, actually, likewise, I've just done some Joanna Macy work and feeling very positive after that. Yeah, suddenly a little bit sleepy though. I don't know if it's just like an afternoon thing. Yeah, anyway, nice to meet everyone.
Okay, thanks, Sophia. Sarah, Helen, Prakash from Shantigarbha.
Hi, I'm Sarah. I live near Inverness in Scotland, and having a nice lazy Sunday. Issues of climate and environment are always important to me, but I don't feel like I don't feel very focused at the moment, but I'm inspired in different ways by the theme of this course, so I'm excited to see what comes from it.
Thanks, Sarah.
Nice to be here. Thank you.
Just a reminder, what a word or a sentence, just so we get a chance to hear from everybody. I think about 20 or more, 25 people on the call. So Helen, and then Prakasha and Sri Sambhava.
Hi, Helen from the UK, now in Tucson, Arizona. So concerned for a whole range of things, feeling pretty anxious, if I'm honest, about everything, and here because it's so good to be with you all from such a big distance.
Okay, thank you. Prakasha and Sri Sambhava, a word or a sentence?
Yeah, hello, I'm in Shrewsbury. And during the relaxation, my emotion was gratitude, and my feeling was red, a bright red postbox colour. So I'll just share that to you all.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Sri Sambhava. I live in Shrewsbury, Shropshire in the UK, and I'm here. Yeah, well, obviously climate matters to me, and I've recently been experiencing a lot of grief. Maybe I'll leave it there. I've been experiencing a lot of grief around what's happening in terms of our planet, and hope that maybe the virus will change things, but also concern that when I hear about trying to get back to normal. Yeah.
Thank you. And we'll come back to that topic of grief a bit later on in the session. Finn, and then Anne, and then Suzanne. A word or a sentence, please, so we get a chance to hear from everyone.
Well, I'm actually feeling hope. I'm sharing all the other feelings, but I'm feeling quite hopeful.
Okay, thank you. Anne, and then Suzanne, and then Claire.
I've been experiencing a lot of apathy lately, and one thing I do when I feel like that is put on films of the sea, because I'm a Swansea girl and was brought up minutes from the sea. And then looking at the beautiful pictures of rolling waves, I realise they won't stay like that. They won't stay beautiful, clean water unless I do something and a lot of other people do something. So then I feel motivated to sort of think, yes, I can. My part will be small, but I certainly can play a part in that.
Thank you, Anne. Suzanne, Claire, Nageshra.
Yeah, hi. I'm feeling full, but connected.
Okay, thanks, Suzanne. Claire, Nageshra, Chris. You're on mute, Claire.
Sorry. Yep. Hi. I'm just feeling as though I've been distracting myself with lots of things. Maybe I shouldn't have been distracting myself. And so I just want to get more focused, and hence just wanting to connect again about this issue.
Thank you. Nageshwar, Chris, Arya Maitri.
Hello, Nageshwar. I'm feeling joyful right now to see you all here. Welcome. I'll leave it to that.
Yeah. Chris? You're on mute, Chris, by the way. Can you unmute?
Yeah, I've got to get the angle of technology. I think I've unmuted myself. So just very happy to connect with other Buddhists. But in terms of climate change, just feel a sense of complete despair and hopelessness, really.
Okay. Thank you, Chris. Ari Maitri, and then Will, and then Louise.
Yes, I am not so positive when I heard from you that in our situation, we can't get this goal we want to have, not more than 1.5 grade more than we have in the moment. And you told us that we will have
3 degrees.
Yes, I would like to hear what this means, so that we really can go against this unhuman conditions.
Thank you very much, Ari Maitri. Will, and then Louise, and then Lila Matti.
Hi, Will from Stroud. Hope that COVID is going to be a springboard for the collectiveness, the community sense or sense of community that we've had. And come on, Greta, we're right behind you.
Louise, Lila Matti, Angela, and then Sidi Sandoval.
Yeah, hi everyone. I'm here today because I feel like I've got the capacity to engage for the first time in a while. So this felt like an opportunity.
Thanks, Louise. Lila Matti, Angela, Sidi Sandoval.
Hi, I'm Lila Matti from Sheffield. Feeling very connected, actually, just seeing lots of other faces of people who deeply care about this issue. So I think I am feeling, and I'm feeling there's a potential turning point in the COVID situation around this. And I love this parable, so I'm really looking forward to joining that together.
Thank you, Lila Matti. Angela, and then Sidi Sandoval.
Hi, I think I missed the instruction. I think we were still in our little group. Is it just to see how I am right now and what I'm looking for?
Yeah, just a word or a sentence. How are you doing?
I'm okay.
Okay.
I'm not sure how I am as far as
fair enough. Climate.
Yeah, I'm really not sure. But it's good.
Okay, thank you. Sidi Sandoval, Tina Shobit.
Hi, Shantigarbha. Thank you for recognising me, my older name. I really love living the simple life on the North Welsh coastline, and I wish that as a Sangha we could find a way to go a bit more sort of on the offensive, so to speak, about exemplifying the joys and benefits of that to help the world reduce consumerism and helping climate change fight.
Thank you, Sidi Sandoval. Tina, and then Shobit, and then M. I don't know who M is, but we'll come to you. Tina?
Yeah, hi together. I'm Tina from Essen. And I'm very aware of my need to connect with community with this topic, you know, to find some inspiration, because I feel quite shut down, quite lethargic with all this COVID. So that's why I'm grateful. Thank you.
Welcome, Tina. Shobit, how are you doing in a word or a sentence?
Yes. Hi, everyone. I'm from India. And one word of metta, because I think so wherever we are one. And because of metta, I'm here doing this meeting with you all. Really looking forward to this Zoom meeting and the different sides that will come out of this. So part of the metta, that is we are one. So due to this, we are connected here as a Sangha. So I'm really enjoying this and looking forward to it. Thank you.
Thank you. M, sorry, I don't know your full name. Would you like to go next?
Yeah, hi, my name's Mary. I'm from Manchester. And hi, I think you've done a session for us at the Manchester Buddhist Centre before, Shantigarbha, which I really enjoyed. And I really care about the climate. At the moment, I'm not feeling that good. I had some technical problems to start with, so I'm on two devices. So if you see Mary N, that's me as well. Hope to be able to stay with you to the end. But if I don't, I'm not feeling so well at the moment. So nice to see everyone. And thank you for running this really important event.
Thanks, Mary. Shradabar, and then Sidi Marla, and then Claudia.
Hi everyone, I'm Shraddha Bahar from Shrewsbury Buddhist Centre.
and how am I feeling like right now? I've been on 3 Zoom webinars this weekend, so I'm feeling a bit tired, and I'd really appreciate some energy, some virya. So I'm hoping that I will get more of it after we've talked about the burning house parable. Thank you.
Thank you. Siddhimala, Claudia.
I'm feeling very well. A lot of gratitude, positivity, deep concern. Again, a few people have mentioned it around conversations from various sources about getting back to normal. This is such a wonderful opportunity. And they all link into me, the courageous conversations, the climate, consumerism, all of it just needs to change. Thank you. Lovely to see and connect with you all.
Thank you.
Thank you, Siddhimala. I'm feeling well, and I'm feeling a deep sense of urgency around climate and also the connection of climate and race relations, and the whole mindset just needs to change. So, and I like the parable of the burning house, so I'm hoping that I can get a new kind of perspective out of that.
Thank you.
Stephanie,
are you with us?
I don't think Stephanie has a microphone.
All right, Stephanie has written something in the chat, so I'll just read it out. I'd like to contribute with my input by saying what's alive in me at the moment. I'm Steph from Manchester, very interested in Buddhism, climate change and veganism. I'm very new to a lot of it, and I would love to find a Buddhist center local to me. Well, there is a Buddhist center in Manchester. Some of the people here are from that center. Okay. All right, we've got that. And Paul Crosland, I think you might be having...
He also has no working setup, so just...
I'm feeling stirred up and glad to be here, wishing I had a working laptop, cam and microphone. Okay, welcome, Paul. Okay, so I think that's everybody. By my reckoning, that's what we've heard from everybody. Is there anybody we haven't heard from? Okay, apart from myself. Okay, I just say, how am I doing? I'm just curious, really. I'm curious what we explore and how we explore it, see where we go. So, you know, yeah, that's how I am at the moment. So I want you to act as if the house was on fire. So this was Greta Thunberg speaking at the EU Parliament in Strasbourg in April 2019. And when I heard Greta say these words, I was immediately reminded of the parable of the burning house from one of the most famous texts in the Buddhist East, which is the White Lotus Sutra. So the parable describes the efforts of a father to get his children out of the burning house. They're busy playing with their games and they ignore his cries. Finally, he finds a way of getting them out of the house. He tells them there are even more exciting and wonderful toys outside the house. The children rush outside to find these wonderful new toys. Now, in the parable, the fire represents the dangers of samsara, a life of unawareness. So how do we face up to the existential threat of climate emergency without falling prey to, let's say, horrified anxiety or helplessness, feeling of helplessness, and we'll explore some of these a bit later on. And how do we do this against the backdrop of a cosmic burning house of samsara? So we'll return to the parable a bit later on in the session. First, I'd like to emphasize that this is a Buddhist response to the climate and ecological emergency. So it's not the Buddhist response, okay? And our tradition strongly recommends that there isn't one uniform response to anything. Our tradition recommends that we think for ourselves. So it wouldn't really, it's not really in the spirit of our tradition to have the Buddhist response. So we'll have different responses depending on where we are and what we're working on at the moment. So there isn't a party line, and I'm not representing, I'm particularly not representing the Tree Ratna party line on this. This is my explorations, my thoughts, my reflections, okay? The members of the Tree Ratna Buddhist Order are free to make up their own minds about the climate and ecological emergency, and they do, and some of them come to very different conclusions from me. So, you know, we're free to make up our own minds, yeah? So that's both a strength in the sense that we're free to act and come to our own conclusions. And sometimes also I wish that there was a bit more collective action as well, a bit more collective, decisive collective action, particularly on issues which seem as clear as this one to me. So my intention today is to create a space for collective reflection. I've been working on a book on this topic for just over a year now. The first sketch came to me while I was on holiday about last July. In about a day, I started scribbling on post-its. I ended up with about 200 post-its, and they're now on my wall upstairs, my writing cave, and that represents the kind of plan, the sketch for my book. So the last 4 months, I've had the luxury, in a way, of spending every morning working on this book. And I've had the opportunity to get more informed about the issues and to explore how the Dharma might support us and the world in this emergency. So the first issue that comes to my mind is it really an emergency? So what's the evidence? Well, for some of you, this is old ground, but just to mention it briefly, according to the IPCC panel report from 2018, a special report, greenhouse gas emissions have already driven up average global temperatures around 1 degree Celsius and limiting further warming to another 0.5 degrees would require halving global emissions within the next decade and then cutting them to zero by 2050. And these statements are tagged with high confidence. So the IPCC has this routine of tagging different statements with different degrees of confidence. These are tagged with high confidence, okay? In 2015, nations pledged to limit global warming to 1.5 to 2 degrees above pre-industrial levels as part of the Paris Climate Accord. You're probably familiar with this. But those governments are largely failing to meet their commitments, and emissions of carbon dioxide and other greenhouse gases continue to rise. Even on the most optimistic assumptions, current national commitments have put the world on a path to around 3 degrees of warming compared with pre-industrial times. As the Earth warms, the Arctic ice melts, exposing us to the far greater danger of methane release as a much more potent greenhouse gas than CO2. Is it an emergency? Well, on geological timescales, it's unquestionably an emergency. Our planet is changing in the geological equivalent of a twinkling of the eye, compared to similar changes in the past, which have had a very traumatic effect on the Earth, on life on Earth. And we're seeing the consequences of those changes already. So to me, this sounds like a fire alarm going off, okay? That's what it sounds like to me. And I'm just kind of curious how it sounds to you, that information. Now, Arya Maitri had a question about what does 3 degrees look like? We don't know. The special report was looking at the difference between 1.5 and 2 degrees. All we can really say with any certainty is that the more temperatures increase And the faster that they increase, the more impact there will be, the more devastating impact there will be. Okay, that's all we can say with any certainty. There's no safe limit to increasing global temperatures. There's no point at which you can say, oh yeah, we're all right now. It's simply that the effects just multiply as temperatures increase. Okay, that's the best information that I have. 3 degrees, the kind of things you can expect are obviously changes in weather patterns, flooding of coastal areas, probably changes in sea pattern, in sea currents, disruption to crops, growing crops, mass migration as a result of some areas becoming hotter and drier, other areas becoming colder and wetter. Yeah, so these kind of things. So those are the kind of things that we could expect with 3 degrees. But of course, we don't know. We do not know. So far, the ocean has absorbed, I can't remember what percentage, but like 75% of the carbon dioxide so far. So it's kind of mopped it up in a certain way, but it's also acidified the oceans. Okay, so horrified anxiety or ignore it completely. Well, as I've been researching the book, I found that I've oscillated between these two, horrified anxiety on the one hand, and just wanting to kind of ignore it and come downstairs and just get on with my life. You know, just kind of, it's just too much to deal with. And I'd also like to hear from you. So would you like to write in the chat, are you for horrified anxiety, or are you for ignore it and get on with your life, or do you oscillate between the two? So I'd like a few people to write in the chat so we could get a bit of a range of different responses here. So do you tend towards going into a state of horrified anxiety, or just ignore it? So what have we got here? Stephanie, stages between the two. Helen, oscillate between deep anxiety and helplessness. Yeah, so helplessness is an aspect of like horrified anxiety. When we just feel the threat is overwhelming. Horrified anxiety from Christine. Shraddha, plan action in the short term helps me to sustain virya. Yeah, okay. Crucial importance of action. Mostly ignoring it this year after a period of deep fear last year. Will, be in the moment. Do what you can now. A bit of hope and a bit of despair. Oscillate between the two, working on equanimity. Between deep anxiety and helplessness. I get really motivated and want to be the change, make a change, but need to connect with others and join the group. Sadness and concern for my 9-year-old and the world he will navigate. Stay productive in stance through learning about solutions. I tend to feel hopelessness that I can't influence what millions do, only my own actions, and even they are far from perfect. Need to take control of what I can, helplessness, do what I can, tree planting, etc., but doesn't change my feelings much. Action, change what I can do in my life, being more accountable, area of concern, area of influence, signing petitions for change, talking about it. So a range. Yeah, we've got quite a range there between horrified and anxiety, helplessness, ignoring it, and also a sense of kind of initiative and wanting to influence what we can influence. Doing what I can to be proactive, to look for things I can still do. Okay, so let's look at horrified anxiety first. So I just want to explore that a little bit more, see what we can do with it. So as students of the Dharma, we know that we need to pay attention to our states of mind, because the states of mind with which we act largely determine the outcomes. Volition is key. Actions based on greed, hatred, and ignorance tend to lead to suffering for oneself and others, whereas actions based on generosity, love, and awareness tend towards happier states. However, we tend to forget this when it comes to the climate and ecological emergency or other kind of things which just seem overwhelming threats. And we tell ourselves, well, we don't have time to transform our minds, or we don't have time to transform enough people's consciousnesses before the flames get to us. This is the kind of thing we kind of, you know, I don't know if I have this kind of fear. However, horrified anxiety is a form of counterfeit compassion. It's a form, it's not really compassion. It's, so when I'm feeling horrified anxiety, I'm identifying with the suffering of those beings, of the people who are suffering from the climate and ecological emergency. I lose perspective, I stiffen, I panic. We're all doomed. I lose sight of other beings. I'm no longer able to be any use to them. So in the short term, the antidote to this is to recognize anxiety in my mind, in my heart and in my mind, and to see how it prevents me from really empathizing with the beings that actually I'm concerned about. What do they need right now and in the future? What's my estimate of their current and future needs? I can be quite objective about it, if I, yeah. And in this way, I can remain of use. I can remain able to contribute to beings now and in the future. As I've been writing, I've been having conversations with Teja Pala, who some of you may know. He's a brother in the Tri Ratna Buddhist Order, and he's a longtime climate activist. And he's been kind of guiding me in the writing process. We've been having dialogues and discussions as I've been going along. He currently lives in Melbourne, and he's been involved in climate activism since about the early 1990s, and he's currently working for the Australian Religious Response to Climate Change. He's been involved in coordinating non-violent interfaith protests against the proposed Adani coal mine and mines. So Teja Pala has taught meditation to climate activists on many occasions and says that what they really need, what climate activists really need, is loving kindness meditations. In his experience, more than anything else, climate activists tend to get into horrified, overwhelmed anxiety. He notices that for himself, he's become more confident and capable through practicing loving kindness, through practicing metta meditation. However, not feeling stressed out has become a bigger challenge as time has gone on. So genuine compassion is a feeling of solidarity with those who are suffering and an awareness of how similar we are to them. And that's combined with an active desire to alleviate their suffering. It means engaging with those beings and what they need to thrive and springing into action to reduce that suffering. Compassion without action is not really compassion. It can very easily dissolve into pity, sentimentality, or a kind of helplessness and depression. I found that since I've been supporting nonviolent actions and writing this book, which is one of my nonviolent actions, even though I know in a lot more detail the challenges we're facing and the likely consequences, I've actually spent a lot less time feeling gloomy and depressed. Sometimes there's genuine mourning. Sometimes I've really felt genuine mourning. Sri Sambhava mentioned that. Sometimes there is a kind of anger, a kind of wrathful anger. I feel a kind of wrathful anger. And I try to connect that with compassion as strongly as possible. I can't say I've felt depressed since I've started being active in this, at least in relation to this topic. I can't say that I've been overtaken by depression. So that's kind of curious in itself. It's like when we start acting, then seems like that actually has a very powerful motivating effect. So we'll just pause there for a moment. I suggest we have a short break. I'd like to hear from five people. Do you want to write in the chat what's coming up for you now? And then we'll have a 10-minute break and then we'll come back. Five people, please. Just if you want to write a quick comment in the chat so I can get some feedback. Angie says, what actions give us hope? Okay, we'll come back to that bit later on. I'll respond to that now. What is one step towards a congruent response to the overwhelming nature of this threat? So, you know, what is one step toward the is a kind of congruent? I look for congruence, yeah? The more serious the threat, the more that affects what kind of actions are going to be taken. Any more? Sarah says, I think that it is the positive thing about our times. You don't have to look far for a way to be of use, to help, to feel compassion. Yeah, yeah. Certainly an immediate kind of area, field for manifesting compassion, for bringing our compassion into the world. Yeah. Is there one more? You're all typing. Compassion with action is not compassion. Well, not the way I understand it. Compassion always has the potential for action, okay? The potential is always there. And if we don't actualize that potential pretty regularly, then it can kind of subside into something which isn't really compassion. It can just become a feeling, as it were. We lose the motivational aspect, the volitional aspect. Siddhi Sambhava, I haven't found taking action has changed my feelings. I'm not overwhelmed by depression, but action hasn't changed that I doubt very much that we'll make 1.5 degrees, okay? Yeah. Angela, despite feeling pretty helpless with big picture solutions, I'm not depressed either. More just realistic about karma and result. My choices do matter. Yes, yeah, so we could reflect on all of this as an example of pratityat samuppada, of conditioned co-production. So the Buddhist tradition generally has encouraged us to reflect on our individual actions and the consequences of our individual actions. However, here we're confronted with the consequences of our collective actions on a scale that is very difficult to imagine. So it's like our ethical imagination is being very seriously challenged by the scale of things. You know, we haven't had to do it before. This is something I was going to mention later, but I'll mention it now. In a way, it's a kind of, you could see this as a crisis of empathy. I would say that because I'm also interested very much in empathy. But it's like we're having to adjust our settings to get used to the scale of the issues, you know, to visualize the data, to get a sense of what the scale of the issues. We haven't had to do that before. It's like we're being thrust into a kind of planetary consciousness in a very uncomfortable way. So it's really deeply challenging for our ethical imaginations, for our empathic imaginations. Shobit says, ability to work with limited resources. Yes, we'll start where you are with what you have in front of you, yeah, with the resources you have available. Yeah. Conversations like this give me hope, says Finn. My actions matter, but a person alone can only do so much, and reminding myself of this reduces my helplessness. Okay, and Angela says, Banti talks of collective karma in Know Your Mind. Okay, so that might be an interesting place to follow up on collective karma. Siddhi Sambhava says, I recommend Ecodharma by David Loy, by the way, a very good read. Yes, that was one of the first books I read, Ecodharma by David Loy. It's in the chat there. He comes at it from a kind of Mahayana Bodhisattva ideal perspective. And yeah, I really enjoyed his reflections. Eco-sattva, somebody invented the phrase eco-sattva. Yes, so somebody who's combining the Bodhisattva ideal with, care for the environment. Sophia says, do people have any other book recommendations? What can I recommend? Well, it depends where you're coming from. Depends what sort of... depends which aspect of this you're looking for. If you're interested in a Theravadan approach, you could have a look at Anālio, Bhikkhu Anālio's Mindfully Facing Climate Change, which is very much a Theravadan approach to trying to establish the case for a Buddhist environmental ethic. So you could look at that. I think in Triratna we tend to look more broadly to, you know, to both not just the Theravadan tradition, but also the Mahayana tradition and so on. So we have a somewhat different approach, but what is there is very helpful. And I particularly enjoyed his meditations on connecting with the earth, like four elements and so on. Yeah, Lila Matty's written that one up. Seeds of Peace by Silax Sivaraksha. Okay, there's more notes there for Christine. Of course, there's Saving the Earth by Akupa, which was written a while ago now, at least 10 years ago now. In fact, I spoke to him when I was just starting this project. I said, was he interested in finding a way to collaborate or doing something jointly? However, he's got some thoughts, but he's not ready to share them. So he's still kind of cooking, as it were. So that was Akupa. Ah, 2005. Wow. Okay, that was Akupa. There's something, climate. Charles Eisenstein is interesting. If you're looking, Active Hope or Anything by Joanna Macy. It's well worth looking at. So she draws in ideas about conditioned co-production. And also an understanding of the different phases that we engage with. I'm going to come back to that a bit later when we talk about grief. Anyway, let us continue. That was the kind of the book section. Let us continue with the session more formally. So we've touched on horrified anxiety and explored that a little bit. Now I'd like to turn to denial, or simply ignoring the threat. And to do this, let's look at the parable of the burning house. Okay, so some of you will know the story, and I'll tell it as a kind of guided reflection. So if you want to just kind of sit back and relax, you feel free. Because it's a parable, it works on different levels. So once there was a wealthy man with many, many children, and these children were playing inside his house. The house was big and rambling, but it only had one gate, we would say one door. One day, the house catches on fire, but the children are distracted by their games, and they're unaware that the house is burning. In fact, they do not understand what fire is, or even what a house is. Their father tries calling to them. No response. He tries shouting at them. No response. They just carry on playing. Finally, in desperation, the father has an idea. He goes to the kids and he says, "Hey kids, outside there's even more wonderful and amazing toys to play with. Shall we go and find them together?" The children rush out of the house to find these new toys. And the father presents each one of them with a toy that is even more wonderful and amazing than anything the children could have imagined. So what does the parable mean to you? What does this parable mean to you? How does it speak to you at the moment? So I'll tell you how it speaks to me at the moment, but I'd like, if you're willing, to just to write into the chat, how does it speak to you at the moment? To just allow it to settle and to percolate this parable, because parables work on many different levels simultaneously. So, here we go. Louis says, it reminds me of Naomi Klein's contention that the climate crisis is an opportunity to build a better world. It makes me feel hopeful. Okay, you feel optimistic, feel hopeful that things of a better world. Okay. Nageshwara, it deepens the faith in a world the heart knows is possible. It deepens the faith in a world the heart knows is possible. Angie says, they don't know what a house is. It makes me reflect that people don't see the preciousness and safety of earth, that is a unique coming together of conditions. Yeah, maybe it's never occurred to them. Finn says, like the kids don't understand the fire, we don't really understand what it means that the earth is warming by 3 degrees in 2050. So maybe we can learn from metaphors, analogies, etc., to work around this. This is my hope, that reflecting in this kind of way will lead to more creative solutions, more creative actions. Yeah. Trying to understand things. You know, Einstein said, you can't solve a problem with the same level of thinking, the same kind of thing that created it in the first place. If you can solve it with the same kind of thinking that created it in the first place, it wasn't a problem, okay? Problems can only really be solved or dissolved by a different, coming at them from a different level, from some kind of different level of thinking, yeah? And so this is where analogy and metaphor really helps, and parable. Alison says, it makes me think of generational amnesia and blindness to changes around us, that we don't see our house or earth changing around us. Yeah, well, one of the things about this particular issue is that we can't sense it immediately with our senses. It's not immediately available to our senses, because these changes, even though these changes are, how can I say, we need a very long time scale in order to pick up these changes. We can't sense it immediately. So we're not really set up to deal with those kind of threats, those kind of challenges. So, yeah, there's a comment by Sophia. Reminds me of Vimla Sara's book on addiction. She says, we can only overcome addiction by finding something we want more than our addiction. Now, that's the kind of direction I'm going in. From that perspective, we need to overcome our addiction to an ego-driven industrial growth society by envisioning and acting to create a future that is better than the society we have. Okay, well, that's the kind of direction I'm going in so far, so I'll come back to that in a minute. Christine, for me, it brings forth the notion of creative response, where the father remained true to his concern for the children and kept trying different approaches. Yeah, he experimented. Yeah, I like that. Didn't abandon the situation in frustration or whatever other unskillful states. But Shobit says, Buddha making us aware that conditions will keep changing wherever we are. Further, he shows we can create better conditions for us and for all. Yes, conditions will keep changing. Now, in relation to the climate and ecological situation, it's the rate of change which is the risk, which is the dangerous thing. It's not that they're changing. Conditions change on the earth are changing constantly. However, in the past, they've tended to change really incrementally, whereas the rate at which they're changing puts stress on ecosystems and makes it difficult for species to adapt. Yeah, so it's the rate of change which is the risky thing, is where all the risk lies. Sarah, sometimes only crisis can force us to open our minds and find new possibilities. Yeah, that reminds me of, some of you will be familiar with this, the Chinese pictogram for crisis is also the word or the pictogram for opportunity. Yeah, so there's an aspect of both there. Sidi Sambhava says, they don't know what fire is. Hopefully we all know after Australia last winter. Okay, if we have some more imagination of what that might be like, yeah, after the bushfires. Kids are not aware of the importance of the word home, which in this way for beings is the earth, another living organism. Yeah, it's like that takes a stretch of imagination. Maybe it's challenging for us, maybe for other people it's just not part of their world, their worldview. So focus on alternative responses that will save the environment rather than saying what we shouldn't do. Okay, so I'm going to pause there because I get, thank you very much for all those responses. I'll read them afterwards. So I'd like to say a bit about what it means to be at the moment. At the moment, what it means to me is that it's not enough to tell people that the house is burning down. That doesn't seem to be enough. That will motivate some people, however, clearly not enough people to make the scale of differences that I imagine need to happen in order to address these issues, in order to address the threats that we're facing. Okay, nor does it seem to be enough to say, well, do it for others. You know, that again, that will appeal to some people, Buddhists included. Again, doesn't seem to be quite enough to motivate a sufficient number of people. So self-preservation doesn't seem to be enough. Appealing to people's altruism doesn't seem to be enough. So when people hear the alarm going off, they wait to see how other people respond. Okay, if the people around them just sit tight or carry on playing, then they just tend to follow suit. However, if people do collectively acknowledge that it's an emergency, then as we've seen with COVID-19, people and governments are able to act swiftly and decisively to make radical changes that were completely unthinkable in other contexts. Yeah? So we do have a modern parallel. We do have, you know, a recent immediate parallel that we can refer to when we're talking about, well, what kind of changes do we need to happen to address this? So what's missing? Well, the father, as we said, the father doesn't just ring the alarm bell louder. He's tried all that before. Instead, he offers his children a vision of more wonderful and amazing toys outside. So what's our equivalent, or what could be our equivalent to more wonderful and amazing toys outside? Well, from a Dharmic perspective, we need to offer something that is even more exciting and wonderful and engaging and enriching and growthful and playful than whatever people are engaged in at the moment. We need to offer some kind of positive vision of how things could be. Rather positive in the sense of not just telling people what not to do, how presenting a vision of how life could be. Not just do this and we won't all get it in the neck quite so conclusively as we might. That's not much of a payoff, I'm afraid. You know, if you start looking into how humans deal with risks and threats, that's the least interesting kind of game that people want to engage in, is damage limitation when it looks like things are going down the pan anyway. Things are going in a disastrous direction anyway. We don't respond very well as a species to threats accompanied by very little payoff, even if we pay attention to the threat. So we need a vision of human potential, or we need a vision of how life could be, of what life could be like. And of course, we do have this in the Dharma. We have a vision of wisdom, of compassion, of living in harmony with the natural world, of achieving our potential as human beings, of spiritual community, of deep reflections on the nature of reality, and so on. So we do have this kind of vision, and of course different aspects of that vision appeal to different people. We do have this kind of vision. So and we do have this sense of this vision of community. It includes community. We'll still need community. We'll still need Sangha to support ourselves and support each other. So I said I'd mention, I said I'd come back to grief. So I'd like to come back to this topic of grief or space for mourning. Perhaps what we really need is space to mourn our losses. Now I know this doesn't necessarily apply to everybody, but I'd like to just explore this for a moment. This is what Joanna Macy suggests in her various books and so on. She says that until we've done our genuine mourning for our losses, we're not going anywhere with our environmental activism. It's just not going to have the kind of the depth, the gravitas, as it were, that we need in order to really be effective. So I'd like to invite you into a space for mourning. So what have you lost in the climate and ecological emergency? What have you lost? What are you afraid of losing? Why is that important? Why is it important to you? Why is it so precious to you? So just take a moment to reflect on that. What have you lost? What are you grieving for? What are you mourning? Maybe species. Maybe ecosystems. Maybe hope for the future, hope for future generations. Maybe some beauty in the natural world. Richness. Maybe peace of mind. Maybe a sense of belonging, a sense of being part of things, being part of the natural world. So in a moment, we're going to go into groups of three for a little bit of sharing. And then we'll come back and we'll pool our experiences. So Aparajita, could you set us up groups of three again, please? Here we go. So to pool our experience, our collective experience. I wonder if you could write into the chat what you've lost. So I put written into the chat there. So what have you lost? And what does it mean to you? Just briefly, so we can get a sense of the variety or the richness of these losses. And also understand something of the importance of this issue to us. So what have you lost and what does it mean to you? Angie says, sorry, I have to leave now. Thank you so much for this wonderful discussion. You're very welcome. Thanks for coming, Angie. Alison says, we felt that we're losing the opportunity to decide what we value. We value money and speed, and we could value beauty and plants and contemplative slowness. Wow. Okay. So we've lost the sense of choice about what we value. It's like it sounds like there's so much pressure coming from the rest of society or the media or advertising or people's attitudes. We're losing a sense of choice about what we value. And our estimates of what we need to have a comfortable life have changed very rapidly over the last 50 years, as you may, if you've looked into the happiness research. In North America, estimates of what we need to be comfortable, minimum that we need to be comfortable, doubled between 1986 and 1994. Yeah, in 8 years, people in the USA, their estimates of what they needed, the minimum they needed to be comfortable, it doubled without them noticing. Okay, we didn't notice. We just kind of assumed that was how it was. Yeah, but we, you know, we're all subject to those kind of pressures. Yeah, me included. Yeah? Louise says, I've lost confidence that the seasons will be here, which means I've lost something of my place in the world. Yeah, a sense of belonging. It kind of really challenges the sense of belonging in the world. I did that, Louise says that I didn't realize I'd relied on. Yeah. Sophia says, connection and hope for the future and for the future of the children. Yeah, that's something we've put as a species, we put a great deal of store by, a great deal of hope into future generations. And, yeah. Christopher says, I lost my job and I work in sustainability. And with that, I lost my chance to participate in changing the mindset of people about climate change. Wow, so you lost the chance to contribute, to make a change, to make a difference. Wow. Sarah says, I mourn a slower pace, depth of connection to nature, self and others. Valuing of beauty, value of having a few things and to take care of them. Wow. So there's an evocation of a different pace of life. Could be more satisfying. In fact, when we remember back to our childhoods, maybe it was more satisfying to have really simplified things, you know, for a different time. Angela says, fellow beings, species, our peace of mind, lack of universal care for life, afraid of losing, more beings, relative safety, more resources to sustain life. Why? I just don't want any extra unnecessary suffering. Yeah, so, you know, as Buddhists, we're all about alleviating suffering. And in particular, where we can make most difference, where we can most easily reduce that suffering. Sidi Sambhava says, plastic-free and radiation-free Fukushima seas. All the oceans are connected, which will take a very long time to get clean again, if ever. So, clean oceans. Claudia, my vision for a safe and prosperous future or world, I guess. Finn, Can you give the sources for the doubling of needs in America? I'd be very interested to read them. So if you get hold of Vajragupta's book, Sailing the Worldly Winds, and if you look at chapter 5, where he talks about scientism and consumerism, he quotes that research there. And that'll lead you on a merry dance to other books about happiness and how we measure happiness. Yeah. So Vajragupta, Sailing the Worldly Winds by Wintour's Publications. It's fascinating stuff. It really is. I hadn't believed how conditioned I was, or how much I've been affected by society and expectations around me. I just couldn't get the scale of it, you know, before reading that myself. Christine says, grieve the loss of innocence and sacred relationship with the natural world. To me, this means that our humanity is becoming coarse, hardened, and insensitive, which feels tragic. Yeah, this is very important. For me, a very, very important point, that acting unskillfully has an impact on us. You know, if we don't act with compassion towards the world, it rebounds on us and reduces our sense of our humanity, our dignity. Yeah. So it's not just the people who are the beings that are affected, it's also the people that the beings that are doing these things which are having the impact who are affected. This is something that Bhante, that Sankarachita, mentioned in an interview when he was talking about his poem An Apology, which is about the apologizing for the impact on the earth. Lost confidence that there is an underlying sense of being in this together, more fragmentation and isolation. Yeah, a sense of, again, a sense of togetherness, a wholeness. And the COVID, one of the things that we've seen from the COVID, the pandemic, is that actually people do come together around a collective crisis, a collective threat. And therein, I think, lies most of our hope, is a kind of seeing it as a collective enterprise. It's something that we all need to kind of, we all need to engage with. We all need to get, you know, put our shoulder to the wheel, as the saying goes. Yeah. So it's a treating it as a collective enterprise, something that affects everybody. And of course, with COVID, that's a threat which affects everybody, not necessarily equally, but it affects everybody. So it has that quality of an existential threat to everybody. And then it that can motivate that kind of community, collective impulse. Yeah. So that therein lies a lot of my hope. Stillness, simplicity, and contentment. Yeah, back to the precepts, back to a vision of stillness, simplicity. There we are. Will shows it on the screen. Yeah, it's a beautiful vision. Yeah. And yeah, the Buddha exemplified that, and we can exemplify that in our lives for ourselves and for other people. Yeah. That actually that could be a lot more satisfying than what we currently have, which is storing stuff in the attic or storing stuff in the garage or whatever. Yeah, we end up with a massive collection of stuff we don't really use, myself included. Peace of mind and ease moving through life. I feel that I have lost these. Fear prevails, maybe causing people to find their comfort in material things. Yeah, quite possibly. We look for comfort in different ways. Some people are going to look for comfort in material things. Yeah. If there's nothing else on offer, that's perhaps where they'll be looking. Siddhimala, I grieve the degradation of what it is to be a civilized society, one where we look after all, the planet, the people, all equally, with metta, kindness, and generosity. The people with respect and sacredness. Okay. So I'll pause there. I can see there are 9 more messages, which I'd love to read out. However, we've reached our 6 o'clock ending or sort of end time. So I'd like just to pause there. I will read those messages, the responses later on. I'm very grateful for how fully you've engaged and given feedback and responded to these questions that have been putting out.
Okay. Could I just briefly thank people for taking the time and trouble to attend today? Much appreciated. And many thanks to Shantigarbha for his time and experience holding the space very nicely and making it very participatory, which is great. So many thanks. The video will go somewhere at some point. We'll let you know.
Okay. Thanks very much, Aparajita, for holding it together technically. And thank you very much for coming, and I really appreciate your participation, our collective endeavour. Thank you.